According to the International Monetary Fund, its executive board has approved $88 million as a payout to Malawi under a new emergency funding program called the Food Shock Window that was set up in response to a surge in food prices and shortages brought on by Russia's war in Ukraine. Let's bring in the CEO of Alpha African Advisory, Sanyade Okoli, to talk about a bunch of these stories on the African continent. Good morning to you. Thank you so much for joining us.
Good morning.
Let's start in Kenya. Did Google have to intervene to aid the government in clamp down of these unused apps or unlicensed apps, excuse me?
I think that, so if we just step back, new laws were brought into force, and essentially these apps that some of us are quite familiar with, with some sharp practices like you know, use of private data. You know, I don't know about you, but sometimes you get calls from random people saying, this person that you know wrote us has borrowed X amount of money and hasn't paid.
Right.
So, you know, using shame tactics, etc. So they've tried to bring some sanity into that sector by saying they have to be licensed. And they had up to September to essentially get these licenses. About 200 and something of these digital credit providers applied. As at September, only 10 had actually received their licenses, and many more were at some stage in the process. So strictly speaking, post the end of September, these digital credit providers are not meant to be operating if they don't have licenses.
Right.
So maybe I should rephrase the question and say, will Google not be aiding and abetting crime?
By not doing what it's doing.
And some people have accused it of being sluggish to respond because it's giving them up to the end of January.
Right.
But strictly speaking,
Should have ended after September.
Then they've also taken another, some would say, pragmatic view to say, for those whose their application is in the process, if they could demonstrate that, then they don't need to come off immediately.
You know, there's these practices, there's also the loan sharks and so on. Do you think this is a byproduct of the drive towards financial inclusion for much of Africa? That, you know, because these folks, some of them can't get loans from traditional banks, so they go online using these apps and they're taking advantage of it. Is that somehow a fallout from that, from this financial inclusion drive?
Can I rephrase that? Not to be contrarian today.
You can do anything you want on this show. Go ahead.
I think it's less so as a result of the drive and more as a result of the yawning gap.
Okay.
And these service providers seeing the opportunity and going for it. Because when it comes to financial inclusion, though, yes, you have the banks, you have, you know, different services out there, the key issue is affordability of credit products, particularly for individuals and SME businesses.
Right.
And so you've got this huge opportunity where these segments require money quickly, because, say, take, for example, in Nigeria, you have, for the banks, you have rules on collateral required, et cetera, et cetera. And a lot of people simply do not have the collateral. The banks aren't going to move fast enough. To be honest, I know we're going to talk about it, but it's similar to Malawi, this loan. It's an emergency, it's an emergency loan, right, that they're getting from IMF. It's 1 year.
Yeah.
So people need emergency money, especially in the context of what's going on globally.
Yeah.
And they go to these loan sharks and pay sometimes really more than eye-watering interest rates.
Yeah. Thank you for explaining that. Yeah, we'll get to Malawi in a second. Ghana, what do you make of this gold for oil strategy that the Ghanaians are looking to?
Can you see my fingers? It's like, what is going on?
Yeah.
I think the nicest way I can put it is I don't fully understand the rationale.
Yeah.
But on a more serious note, it is an uncommon practice. What you're more likely to have are oil-producing companies, countries getting non-oil products for their own oil products.
Right.
But it begged more questions than it answered. And I think for something like this, really, if an announcement is going to be made, it really should have had a bit more detail so as not to result in poor signaling. So how is it going to work? Because we already know that you have these bulk importers, right? is the government going to give them the gold? Because they don't ordinarily have gold.
Right.
Gold is another commodity, which means the price is
still
can be quite
volatile. Right.
So are the oil suppliers expected to take on the risk of the gold pricing?
Mm.
Well, no, not really, because the only two ways they can play it is one, they decide they're not going to trade with Ghana, or they price things, they price that risk in. And then you can say, okay, well, I'm sure the intermediaries, you know, whenever there's an opportunity, there's a gap, people will see it, right? Intermediaries will come in. But then again, there's going to be a cost to Ghana, because the moment you introduce new risk, people will price in the risk. That's just the nature of markets. So like lots of questions in my mind. And one that might seem a very silly question is, why don't they just sell the gold and replenish their reserves?
Because it's still priced in dollars anyway.
It's priced in dollars, and gold, there's a ready market for it. It's not like it's my financial services that you say. You know, it's like there's a very ready liquid market for gold. Sell it, replenish your reserves. Keep it simple.
See, that's why you're the CEO of Alpha African Advisory. That's what you do. So South Africa, you're probably the best person to ask this as a woman, as a chief executive. What do you make of this? What do you make of the climb in the female board on boards in the
GSA? Trajectory. We're making progress. But then, sorry to just slightly...
Be honest. Go ahead.
On the flip side, in August, PwC came out with a report to show that when it comes to executive management...
Those numbers are where you are.
It's been very, very slow. So for the JSE top 100 companies, guess how many are run by women?
15%.
Seven.
Ooh, gosh.
Seven. So there's... But 15% is overall executive management. For the JSC listed. So well done.
That was a total guess. I just guessed.
But it's where, as a woman and as society, we should be pleased when we see things headed in the right direction. But let's not rest on our laurels. A lot more work needs to be done. And that report also said that you have an increasing number of women being chairpersons of the JSE listed entities. An interesting fact is that the women on average are 3, 4, 5 years younger than their male counterparts.
How about that?
So I thought that was
interesting. All right, so youth and female representation. Malawi, quickly, I know we're running out of time. There's a flyer I want to show you, and this is just, I don't know what to make of this. The loan that the president got, he got congratulated by, it's hard to talk about this with a straight face. Yeah, there it is. He was congratulated for getting the loan from the IMF. I don't know if this is we see this here in Nigeria, right? Where we have heads of state get congratulated for all sorts of things. I don't know if it's, you know, sycophancy or what, but
I think Rachel, the fact that you are laughing already tells me you do know what to make of it.
Right?
But what I will say is that why they're taking the loan? Food shock. The pricing of food inflation. So in the world, we've faced two shocks in the recent past, in the last few years. Who's to say what shock will come?
In the future, right?
So when, as leaders, we are in such a volatile, uncertain time, there's a level of sobriety that is required in dealing with the affairs of nations, because millions and millions of people, their lives are affected. This, unfortunately, does not demonstrate the level of sobriety and even understanding. This was not a grant. And here's an interesting thing, because as I read these different stories, it's very interesting to see what a government leader says today and the outcomes we see in the news a year, 2 years from now. And I think we could all do well with going back to see what some of our political leaders have told us in the past, compare it to the outcome, and begin to make more informed decisions about, you know, the choices we make. You know, elections are coming up in several of these countries. But it is unacceptable. Yeah, and it shows a lack of understanding, even if sycophancy was the driver.
Gotcha. Finally, about minutes ago, are you shopping on Black Friday? Is it a scam? Well, the South Africans don't seem to, at least those on Twitter, they don't seem to be fans of Black Friday. And today is Black Friday. So.
Permit me to use a Nigerian phrase. Which one consigned us with Black Friday? The truth is, we've tried to import this concept that, you know, used to be very much a US-centric thing. And now everywhere in the world, we're all talking about Black Friday. And yes, they are right. Some of the sales are so underwhelming. It's actually embarrassing. It really is a don't waste my time kind of thing.
So
I
get what.
No, but of course I will be looking.
Okay,
I will be looking.
So you want to see? Of course.
Absolutely.
Always great to have you on the show. The CEO of Alpha African Advisory with some great advice for Ghana on how to boost their reserves. Sanyade Okoli, thank you so much for joining us. Really appreciate your time.